Hi there, my name is Steve Foy and I work at Kineo in Brighton. Thanks for joining this talk. I hope you'll find it interesting and useful. I'm going to talk about how we partnered with the Institute of Practitioners in Advertising, the IPA, to help them transform their learner experience, their user experience across the board for all the CPD courses that they run for people in the advertising and communications sector. But first of all, I'll just give you a little bit of an overview of who I am and who Kineo are. So Kineo, what do we do? Well, we're experts in learning technology, and our passion really and our commitment is to use technology and great design to create the best and most effective learning experiences that we can for our customers. That's across the not-for-profit sector, but also a myriad of other sectors as well. So we've got lots of work that we can share if people are interested. Just get in touch at the end and we can share some of that work with you. We're also very proud to be part of the City and Guilds Group. Now, the City and Guilds Group, as many of you probably know, has had a key focus on helping individuals and organisations worldwide, really, develop their skills, their technical skills and their vocational skills for organisations, for individuals. And they've been doing that for 130 years. So we're really proud to be part of that heritage. But I'll sort of whiz through the slides on Kineo. If you want to find out more about us or about City and Guilds, you can kind of get in touch. We can tell you all of that stuff. Suffice it to say that at Kineo, we do animations, we do digital learning, we do learning platforms, all of the things that go hand in hand you would expect to be a modern learning experience, especially in the advent of global pandemics. You know, the kind of move to digital and virtual communications has really never been more at the forefront. So really, what are the IPA? What do they do? And how did we come to partner with them? Well, give you a little bit of context. The IPA is the largest and I suppose the premier membership organisation for people who work in the advertising and communications sector. Really. And they've been around for nearly 20 years. And their industry represents roughly £120 billion to the UK economy each year. So a really massive part of UK PLC. And you know, it has prestige and it has a very high profile around the world. Everybody knows about, you know, advertising standards in the UK and the IPA are very behind that. They want to be part of the industry as well as serving their industry. They're thought leaders, they want to provide CPD, and really their goal is to transform advertising and marketing communications from a professional industry, which it clearly is, into a profession. So, and they do this through a number of flagship communications, flagship qualifications rather. Now, we partnered with them around about 5 years ago when they were looking to overhaul what they already had. They had been delivering CPD with a considerable amount of success, but it was getting to a point where that content was now, the content itself was excellent, and they have obviously the best subject matter experts in their field. But it was quite volatile content. The world of technology, the world of advertising, the world of creative industries, they're moving so fast. And that means that things can quickly get out of date. So when they got in touch with us, they had sort of realized that while they had been at the vanguard of their industry in terms of delivering digital communications, the user experience was starting to fall behind slightly. And when you're dealing with an industry which is very cutting edge, very tech savvy, and very, very kind of used to consumer grade media content, the learning experience and the offer that was sort of put out there needed to sort of match that, those expectations really. So they chose us after a competitive tender to work with them on a multi-year kind of program of redesign, improvements, overhaul. And what we did really, we started off with the basics really. We took the very first qualification, which is their foundation qualification. This is the qualification there, sort of past learners. And really what we found was the course structures themselves, the content, while it was, you know, extremely high quality, was quite linear, and the structure was quite linear, quite audio led, quite rigid. There was one way to sort of work your way through that content, and it was, you know, wasn't perhaps always the right way for every type of learner. It wasn't necessarily an easy course to access if you just have small pockets of time in the midst of a busy career. So it was very much a kind of a monolithic, text heavy, audio led course. You know, we're all familiar with that. We've all gone through courses that are like that. So we have this sort of dense course, quite difficult to sort of enter and tackle. Lots of repetition because it was written with the notion that you would start and work your way through this giant course. It wasn't as concise as it could be, and I think that's because it came from a background of, I suppose, more classical education, where you know you might not be dipping in and out. It wasn't necessarily designed for performance support or going back to things to refresh yourself. It wasn't really, from a technical perspective, it had fallen behind the kind of rapid change that we saw in the mid-noughties, where suddenly everybody moved to tablets and mobile devices. Didn't work on those devices, or at least very poor compatibility. And really just, it was quite a low representation of the sort of media that people who work in the advertising industry and the creative industries would be used to. So not much in the way of animations, not much in the way of videos, or where there was video, it was lengthy pieces rather than those kind of short, snappy, kind of bite-sized chunk videos that we're now used to. It didn't necessarily represent industry voices. And by that, I mean, there was kind of an absence really of upfront expert voices, as well as more junior voices of people starting out in their careers. And we thought that was something that could be changed. It could be made to resonate more with kind of the people starting out in their career in the advertising industry if those people appeared. And then really the other thing that they wanted to tackle was that they had the foundation certificate was a blended course. So there was, you know, an element of digital, there was also an element of workshop based training, and an exam as well. So they had moved to an online exam, but it was in a separate system. The systems didn't talk to each other. There were problems with performance, robustness, integration of those systems. I won't go into the detail, but it was far from streamlined, and the IPA were aware that these things needed to change, and they wanted to sort of start tackling that. So that's kind of what we set about changing for the learner. And it's worth kind of, I suppose, stopping and pausing really for a moment, because when they started out on this journey and they went out to tender, I think there might have been some idea that they needed to move everything to be digital, and that it all needed to be interactive. And what we found when we talked to past learners was that far from replacing everything they had with something new and interactive, those past learners actually said that, you know, that wasn't really what they wanted. What they ideally want is some e-learning, some digital interactive content, but also some other things they could just download and read. So PDF, for example, or maybe an infographic, things that would summarize the content or give them a case study to take away and read when they're commuting to work, that kind of thing. So we kind of knew that we needed to keep that blend very carefully balanced so that it wasn't all digital or all face-to-face, but kind of use the best of all the different available media to enhance that learning experience. So the IPA team themselves, now obviously the IPA is a membership organisation, they're not for profit. They didn't have a huge team of people working on digital learning content. And really the problems that they had experienced over the previous, I suppose, nearly 10 years or so that they'd been delivering digital learning was that as a small team, trying to run this kind of operation and keep that learning out there, the problems they'd run into really were that they didn't have a huge amount of autonomy. So if they needed to change some content, and as I've said, that content did need to change periodically because the topic areas are quite volatile, things were moving quickly. There was quite a lengthy process where they had to go back to their third-party provider at the time, request the change had to be made, it had to be reviewed, republished, but they couldn't do any of that stuff. That had to all be done by their third party. So the content was kind of almost out of their hands. And the platform itself that the content was being delivered on was a proprietary platform, not open source or kind of widely used. The only people that could manage that platform were the provider that the IPA were then working with. So that added to that time frame, it added to that kind of process and that sort of complication. And then really just sort of coming back to really sort of IT basics, the platform that they had experienced problems. It was sometimes performing slowly, pages were taking a long time to load. They were getting a lot of support queries from learners and from members who were unsure whether their completion data had been saved or whether, you know, what happened to the learning that they were doing. And you can imagine that all of this creates a kind of a swell of extra work for a small team. And that was just an unsustainable model, really. They didn't have an adequate support SLA in place to get those things changed. And just on the sort of final point, really, before we move on to talk about what we did, they were getting around about 30% dropout rates from their courses, which is not great, obviously. And I think it's kind of testament to some of the problems that I've just been talking about, really. The user experience, whether it's about the design of the content, the robustness of the platform, the user experience is affected by all of these things. So, you know, there were a lot of things to look at and tackle for Kineo when we partnered with the IPA. So I'm really going to talk about next how we tackled those problems and you know, go into some of the results. If we look at what we needed to do, I talked about the consistency, roughly 2 weeks, just to kind of get, I suppose, a clear idea of what the priorities were, what needed to change. Now, there were going to be some things that were quick wins, and there were going to be some things that related just to content, or some things that related maybe just to the platform. So we kind of broke them all down into different work streams. The qualification itself, we put that down as one work stream where we would tackle, look at, review all the content that existed at the moment, and then just try and carve it up into, remove the repetition, remove the density, design that content to be read on screen, but also look at opportunities for areas of content which didn't need to be interactive or digital, could be just made into a PDF which could be downloadable. And we came up with a blend design document. That blend design document went to the IPA, they reviewed that, and then there was a little bit of tweaking to get the balance right, so that we had the right balance of videos to e-learning, to PDFs, to podcasts, and it did include all of those things. And then we moved on to the sort of in parallel, roughly, we went onto a platform. So we kind of came up with a platform design. We used Totara Learn LMS, and which they still use to this day. And we came up with a nice, simple, elegant design for that program. And we launched one program in the first instance, and then the plan of kind of increasing the number of platforms, the number of programs and qualifications that would be added to that. Each qualification had its own brand and its own color scheme, so it was very easy to differentiate for the learner which course they were in, because there are some learners who do multiple courses with the IPA. So we kind of tackled all of those things. We used a number of different kind of enhancements and sort of additional bits. So, for example, the content they had before was not responsively designed, so the course that we designed absolutely was responsively designed. We added a native mobile app as well, so that people could download content, save it, work on it offline, and then when they go back online, that content could then sync it, their completion results back to the LMS. And all of the other things that I've sort of talked about, like blend, use of video, use of animations, those things were all integrated wherever they could be. Now, the IPA didn't have a huge budget. They're not a corporate blue chip organization. So we had to kind of get the balance right for the learning design, but also make it fit within a finite budget. So that's a process that we went through with the IPA to get the most out of their budget, really. And it also meant that, because this was the first qualification we did for them, represented roughly 30 to 40 hours of study, we had to produce many of a certain number of elements. So there would be several podcasts, there would be several animations, several video styles, e-learning, but it meant that we were able to deliver certain economies of scale. So we would have a template for each of those different types of resource, and we could then sort of blast through those and create as many as we could at the same time, so that it would basically, you get the most for your money. So coming back to what we did, a sort of high level, we had the blend design, we had the new platform, which was going to be put on a server, which was robust, delivered the sort of speed and performance that people expected. We also sort of worked on capability building for the IPA team. So obviously one of the issues that they had before was that they didn't really have any control over the content or the platform. So that was an easy one to tackle. And particularly since the IPA team had an incredible appetite and a real dedication to upskilling themselves. So we delivered training sessions on how they could manage their own courses on the LMS, and how they could update courses, change them, add things, remove things, how they could do their own reporting. And we also had the ability to, I suppose, with the content that we were creating for them, they're experts in their content, we were the experts in the digital design of that. They wanted to know how they could change things, simple things themselves, without having to keep coming back to us and paying money for it. So we showed them how to do that as well. And they were excellent at that. They kind of cascaded those skills down, shared those skills amongst the team, and they had, and essentially that team transformed itself under the team leader there. So it was just a joy to work with them, really, and wonderful to see, you know, how that team grew. And the learning curve was steep for them, but they never really shied away from that. So that's kind of what we did in a real nutshell. Obviously, I'm going at speed and haven't gone into huge amounts of detail. But just to give you some examples of the sorts of things that we did. I talked about industry voices. So this is where they've used an expert to come and talk about a very key concept in their industry. So what do we mean when we talk about creativity? So in this case, they have an expert talking about that. And we used what for us then was a new kind of feature, which was interactive video, where the video would play, there'd be pauses in that video where you would be asked a question, you'd have an opportunity to reflect on something, and then you'd be able to answer that question. So in this case, partway through this video, the learner stops the video and is asked to reflect on what they think creativity is. So they answer one of these questions, they select an answer, and then after that, this was a kind of new feature for us at the time, which was where we would use data of past responders to the question to show how the individual's question or the individual's answer stacked up against how other people had answered that question. So it's a bit like going to Amazon, and when you select something, put it in your cart, it'll say other people who bought this also bought this. It's just kind of reflecting where your viewpoint stands in the grand scheme of things. We also used small videos, very short videos, which were recorded incredibly cheaply and kind of sort of almost reportage style, where people would talk to camera and they would talk about key moments in their early career where they were forced to reconsider something or where they'd learned a valuable lesson, possibly by making a mistake. So, you know, the sort of war stories type thing. And this is a, you know, really, really valuable part. It's these people resonate with a new learner because these are people who are only a few years into their career themselves. Just to kind of sort of highlight really the fact that there was a workshop element to these qualifications as well. So, you know, as well as doing the digital course, people got together in London and there was networking, there was thought leadership, there was, you know, opportunities to get together and share ideas. And this is a photo taken at one of the workshops that the IPA ran. Now, subsequently, in fact, just before the pandemic, we worked on a project to overhaul this and turn it into an online workshop as well, because what the IPA found was that not everybody can come to London for a workshop, but lots of people still want to get that experience. So there's a virtual version of this as well, which has been launched just in time, as it happens. So that's a very brief overview of what we did. I'm just going to quickly flip through the results. So learner feedback. Now, on the platform and the learning content that we've designed for the IPA, the previous overall score of people who'd voted it good was 74%, and then after the redesign it went up to 96%. So there's still some way to go, but we were very pleased with that, and I know the IPA sort of considered that as a success. So that's a great bit of feedback. There were some unexpected results as well. So you know, you may remember that, you know, at no point when I was talking about the goals for this project was there a goal around saving money, but actually there were some considerable savings overall. Across all the redesign qualifications we've done for the IPA, they estimate that they've saved over 100k since the start of that partnership, which is no small fee, really. But just, you know, to be very specific, they felt that they had reduced their support bill by roughly £11,500. That's just by being able to do more themselves, having that increased autonomy, not having to go out for every kind of word change or kind of changing an image here and there. And then annual savings of around £23,000 just on the reduced time to update qualifications, because they were moving to an open source platform with open source framework for the e-learning. And that meant that, you know, there was no reliance on one individual provider or one person to do that. They could do some of it themselves. They could get another provider to do it if they wanted to. As it happens, we made some of those changes for them, but it was much cheaper, much more streamlined. And I think you know, the we've continued to work with IPA over the last 5 years. It's been a very fruitful partnership, and you know, long may it continue. It's been an honour for us to kind of work on those projects. I'll just going to finish off with a couple of things. So some learner testimonies. These are people who've been on the course in the last year, and really nice feedback from these people who are starting out in their career. The IPA Foundation certificate gave me a 360 view of the market and highlighted the areas that were not part of my everyday job. Overall, it was a really nice experience, and I will use the gained knowledge from this day forward. So obviously that's the kind of thing that you absolutely want to hear about our work. We often don't find out too much from learners about how our work goes down. We deliver work to lots of corporate blue chip clients, all sorts of different large organizations. We don't often find out from the learner how they found it, but it's really nice to work on a project like this where we have that direct contact. Finally, before I sort of sign off and let you go about your day, I just wanted to share one thing with you. So as you can imagine, the IPA is going to be rather good at marketing their own qualifications, and there's no, you know, no surprises there. And so for the foundation certificate, which is their sort of flagship starting qualification for people in the industry, they created a nutshell video. So they call these in a nutshell. They've also done these for other qualifications that they run. And if you're interested in seeing these, they're all on YouTube. There's an IPA channel. You can sort of see the foundation certificate in a nutshell. Hopefully this will work on this webinar. Just give you a very quick snippet of this. This is the video that they use as part of their comm strategy. And just as an ongoing video for anybody considering going on the foundation certificate qualification, this video tells you what you can get from that course, how it's going to help you in your career, what kinds of elements and resources will be available to you, and really, you know, what the commitment is as well, which is a very important thing for people working full time. So I'll start this, play a little bit, and then I'll finish off.
The best way to see the future is to create it. Boost your career in the world of advertising, media and marketing communications by taking the IPA Foundation Certificate. 30 hours of online training created by experts and industry visionaries will provide you with everything you need to kickstart your career and shape the future of brands. Regardless of whether you have ambitions to succeed in the agency or client world, the learning will help you to understand consumers, their motivations, and how to influence their purchasing decisions by understanding.
So hopefully that gave you a little bit of a flavour. If anybody wants to see any more of this content in detail, there's plenty on YouTube. But do get in touch with us here at Kineo. I'll be happy to share some of the work that we've done with the IPA, the not-for-profit sector, and in any other sectors that you're interested in, really. So there are lessons to be learned from all the sectors we find. So we're very happy to share some of that stuff. Do get in touch. All it remains really for me to say is thank you very much. And I'll leave you with the details. So thank you for your time. Have a great event. And hope to hear from some of you if you're interested. Thank you. Take care.